Good morning. This is already third day. Hope you learned a few things. And today we are going to talk about traffic signal design. I'm not sure how many of you know this topic in depth. I'm going to assume you do not have much of knowledge. So we'll have a morning 2 hours talking about this. And then in the afternoon, we'll try to do optimization of a timing plan using Excel and using genetic algorithm. And then we'll talk about multimodal component of transit signal priority. That's going to be today's lectures and tutorial. So the basics of a signal timing plan, obviously we want to know why we put the signals. The cost of a traffic signal is not trivial, at least in the US. If you want to install fully loaded traffic light controllers and posts and everything, it's about $150,000, almost $200,000. So it's not cheap, but it does have a huge mobility benefit. As you have more cars approaching at the intersection, two-way stops or four-way stops are not going to work when it exceeds a certain volume level. So signal actually gives right-of-ways to make it much safer as well and better efficiency. Cost and maintenance. And then also, as the demand changes in the network and then volume slightly increases, timing plan could be outdated and they need to be updated. But a lot of agencies, they do not have a budget or efforts to time and efforts to update them as frequent as needed. So that's one downside, and obviously a lot of the cost associated with it. This is a report given by the timing having to be up to date. So if you keep the good timing plan, you can actually reduce delay up to 40%. Travel time up to 25%, stops are reduced up to 40%. Somebody actually converted this into how much benefit we could give to drivers, public. So assume each person is spending about 2 hours per day for commuting and also going to the grocery or go to restaurant and activities. And if we add up these percentage, and it could be about 50 hours per year. That means you have extra 1 week of vacation. So kind of sales pitch to make sure that timings are updated. In case you ever wanted to talk about who actually started this traffic signal very first time, this is 1868 in London. As you can see here, it's not traffic light. It's basically go and stop indicator. And then person is actually turning around and giving the guidance. This was needed because if you do not have a priority given to other approach vehicles, and there's a lot of weavings and congestions. So this was one idea they started it. And in the US, they had a first electric traffic signal in Cleveland, Ohio. Not sure why that was the first place. And then Salt Lakes and others, that's 1914, so it's been almost a century or longer. And believe it or not, they had an actuated signal in Baltimore, Maryland in 1928. Actuated meaning that they changed the duration of green time based on the demand, so it's a good. So the control of the intersections, you don't have to have an intersection as a traffic signalized one. You can have a stop controlled, yield controlled, or traffic light controlled, and you know you have roundabouts and other things as well. One question you might have is that how do we decide which one's most appropriate? And who actually decides that? If you actually have money and ways of putting traffic signals, It's not going to be the best option when you have a low traffic volume. One evidence is that maybe it's not in India. In the US, some of the intersections are going into flash yellow, flash red mode at night. Those flash red is a stop sign. Flash yellow, you sort of yield and then you have right away. It's a making two-way stop control intersection. So it's a basically telling that with the low volume, signals are not the best option. So the volumes are one indicator to decide whether we should do signal or not. But again, who's going to decide this? It's going to be the politicians affecting, I need a traffic light in my neighborhood, or a city major has, the mayor has a say to need one, or citizens complaining about we need to have a signal, traffic engineers deciding what to do. What's the most important one is basically using the something called the MUTCD. It's a documentation trying to maintain uniform control devices, and they have a device information about how to determine traffic control device at the intersections. It's called the warrants. The warrants was developed and it has evolved over time as well. So we rely on this. And some of the policy questions are traffic calming versus efficiency. If you have actually really bad coordination between the intersections, some people think that that's achieving traffic calming. So everybody stops every intersection. Or efficiency-wise, you want to have a good progressions. How do you have the policies on those? And also needing to have an engineering study. This is, again, the issue of lawsuits and liabilities. When the warrants on this MUTCD is not about we shall have a traffic light if the conditions are met. It's not. It's basically triggering, we call it engineering study to figure out do we really want to install traffic light? And this usually goes with priorities. So you have maybe X number of intersections that actually met with the warrants. And you don't have money for 10. Usually you don't. And you have to make a priorities. And then where you have engineers are coming in and look at the conditions. They also consider safety concerns, the number of crashes, not just delays and volumes. So engineering study is a very important component. They also use HCM for understanding the level of service, often do the simulation analysis as well. So the management of traffic signals are based on the do we need a new signals? And then when we need a signal, how do we design them? How do we put the settings? And we want to have a field evaluation whether this is working as we expected. Oftentimes, we rely on a simulation tool to sort of estimate what's going to happen of new signal, new timing plan. And especially when you have the coordinated system, they don't work exactly they want to. And often engineers go out in the field and observe conditions and change the offsets a few seconds or change the amount of durations a few seconds as well, so they can improve signals. And also, people can consider removal of signals. Some are in favor of roundabouts. So taking out the signal and putting the roundabout. And most studies show that roundabout is safer in terms of crash severities. And think about the intersections. If you have red right runners, the crash has a high severity versus the roundabout. It's usually a rear end crash, usually not that severe ones. And also, it often provides a much higher capacity than intersections. The challenge, at least in the US, at the early stage was people don't know how to drive at the roundabout. Should I yield to go in, or should I wait until I find a gap, kind of thing. And then they actually do well now, and then US is adopting more roundabouts as well. Some of the decisions, obviously the warrants study is helping you decide a new signal is needed. And then design and settings, We can do the signal design and optimizations. Some of the design elements could be lane assignment. Do you want to have a left and through going together versus separate left turns? It's also an interesting design element. And obviously optimizing it, how long the cycle should be, and duration of green times are important. Field evaluation, all these are basically common sense of knowledge. We can look at the queue length as one easy way to evaluate conditions. Looking at it as the corridors and do the sort of pro-vehicle trial runs. So you just drive through the area. And nowadays, the people actually use the GPS. They can tell at the end of the run which signal is getting the progression, where you stop them, can you make some improvements, and things like that can be actually easily done. Going into the signal control parameters, you probably know these cycle length, green time and clearance interval, phase sequence, and offsets for coordinated systems. How many of you do not know this? Oh, this is really basic, so we could easily go skip. Okay, so phase is very easy. Indication of the concurrent green indications. So whatever, this is a simple two phases. When you have two phases, usually main street greens are on, and then second phase, cross street greens are on, fairly easy. Left-hand treatment is kind of interesting. I don't know how much you understand this treatment of left turn is important. Used to be driver's expectancy is that left turns coming first and then throughs. And when you do have this operation only, and certain spacing of the intersections, it's very difficult to provide a progression because you have a duration of left turns, and then that's blocking how you actually operate the offsets. So by switching this left turn to maybe through and then left, you can actually provide a better progressions. And concern was that people do expect that left comes first and then through. There was some concerns about safety. So in the US, if they do change, they show that green comes first at this intersection or something like that. This is also useful for both directional, bidirectional progressions. So one case, you need the left first to make a progression. The other direction, you might need a through first to make a better progression. So that's one way to treat them. And this can be optimized as well. I mean, you cannot do manually all these for 5, 10 intersections. And optimization can take care of this. That works as well.
Just to clarify, in our situation, it will be right turn. We are driving on the opposite.
Thank you very much. thank you. Right turns. Thank you. So it's still the right of way, not left of way though. Cycle length, you know, the duration of the sequence of the phases and then green times all together. This also plays a role in terms of peak, off-peak, and non-peak hours. Usually we need to have a longer cycle for peak hours, more cars need the green times, and then when you go into midday and off-peak, you might need a shorter cycles. The challenge, obviously, is that changing between these two cycle lengths. If it's not coordinated, no problem. But if you have multiple intersections are being coordinated, then transition between the one cycle to another is not a trivial. And this is going to be a problem for emergency vehicle preemptions. I don't know how much is in India. When the fire trucks and ambulances, they can actually request for green at the intersection. And usually in the US, once you complete the so-called minimum green time, you open up green time for whoever is requesting these preemptions. And this is actually helping, saving lives, and it's very good, but this is disrupting the progression as well. So that's some challenge that needs to be addressed well. Again, green times are easy. Yellow and then all red. Not sure, do you understand the all red time? and which is not easy to observe, obviously. So when you have end of green and we provide yellow, and then sometimes yellow is not long enough. This is for safety, obviously. If the car is trying to get through the intersection, when they saw yellow and then they don't stop and they are continuously traveling, and oftentimes they are still in the intersection at the end of yellow. And typically we add about a second of all red. It means that every phase of the signal is seeing red time that clear up those vehicles. Obvious downside is that people do know that they still try to get in, and it's not good, but we need to have that for safety reasons. This is a typical way of doing phase. This is without having pedestrians, so it's fairly easy to give phase 1 and phase 2 and phase 3. So these not dark black one is permissive. So they do not get left turn arrow or right turn arrow. They can just make their own way of making turns. It's fairly common as well, especially if you have a single lane per direction case. And this is when you have pedestrians or bicyclists. They actually have greens are being, I have not started this. Okay, thank you. So during the green time, we have a portion of the green is, obviously this is for when you have intersections, and this guy is showing the green here, then they will have a crossing, right? So the green duration is divided into walk and flash don't walk. So it's a fairly long flash don't walk, and now a lot of intersections are showing the countdown. They show the remaining of pedestrian walk time, so that's good. And then a fairly long don't walk as well. So this will allow to have pedestrians and bicyclists to cross. Again, one of the challenges is that there's a pedestrian crossing time is needed. So typical pedestrian requires about 3 feet per second walking speed, and depends on how many pedestrians are waiting. And you can estimate how long does it take to cross, especially if you have a multi-lane, six-lane road, wide road. And often this is amazing. I'm gonna just try one more time. I'm gonna just exaggerate this. So this is a street. So this is a major street, right? When you are getting green time for cross street compared to major road, your duration of green time is probably very small. It's not 50-50, it's probably 20-80. So your cycle length is even 150 seconds. And your green time is less than 20 seconds or 15 seconds. And during 15 seconds, they cannot cross entire street. It's a big, big challenge. It depends on how many pedestrians or bicyclists you have to serve. If you have a heavy pedestrian volume road, you have to make sure that green times are long enough, even though cars are not utilizing it. Or if it's a low pedestrian volume in the US, they just have a pedestrian actuation button. Person pushes it, and then only that cycle is providing long enough green for safely crossing entire road. So that's something to keep in mind. And showing the same thing with the controllers and different phases. Different textbook or different controller uses slightly different names for the terminologies, but you probably can figure it out. Cycle lengths and phase are similar to the durations of the phases or intervals, yellow and red clearance time. Offsets are key to making progression along the major corridor. So by definition, it is showing time difference between the beginning of green time at the one intersection or best intersection to the beginning of green time at the other intersection. So when cars are started moving at the beginning of green, and then they travel to the downstream intersection, we want to make sure that they can see the green time. One challenge is if there is a remaining vehicle as a queued vehicles, and when they arrive on time, it assuming no queued vehicles, is creating problems. So we'll have to add a queue clearance time into the offset calculations. That's another challenge. And then you have to do the both by directions. Sometimes that's not easy. So that's the real basic of the signal timing plans. I want to explain the highway capacity manual, how they do in terms of signal control. Have you learned this from the Indo-HCM? Some, not everyone, okay. It's probably same similar concept. So they start with the level of service concept. It's affecting based on the number of vehicles, obviously, and also distribution of the vehicle. Lane utilization is one thing, and also heavy vehicles are another thing, and also geometric conditions. More the lanes, you can push more vehicles out. And one thing we are focusing on is obviously signal system in terms of cycle and green times and those settings. So these are settings, once you have a signal, it's fairly easy to update. So it's a very cost-effective way of improving mobility and also safety as well. MOEs is called control delay. I think I mentioned a little bit. Control delay is, so they evolved from stop delay to approach delay, and now they call this control delay. Stop delay only considered complete stop times. So when you actually come into the intersection and you stop because the traffic light is red, and how long you stop them is the key elements. And then they begin to realize that vehicles are also delayed while slowing down to stop, and then stop to the accelerating to gain whatever their speed. So this is a so-called approach delay. And then they also realize that cars are interacting each other. If you are on the leftmost lane and try to make a right turn, and then that's going to have interactions with other cars. And that's creating delays. Or do a lot of lane changes causing effect. So they include everything as a control delay. And because of this, used to be level of service effort was 60 seconds per vehicle. Now they made it as 80 seconds per vehicle. Again, this is a consensus. This is probably a very high level of how signal intersections are analyzed. They are focusing on demand side and supply side. So if you are taking economics 101, demand and supply is the basic concept for determining microeconomics. And here, demand is given by how many cars are coming in. And instead of counting just number of cars they arrive, HCM, I need to look at the peak of 15 minutes. And don't ask me why 15 minutes. It could have been a minute, but they decide to have a 15 minute as a good interval for collecting cars back in probably 60s and 80s. And using that information, and they are trying to look at the worst 15 minutes. And they want to deal with worst 15 minutes happening for entire hour. In part of the reason is that if you have a four different approach, having eight different turns, like a throughs and right turns, and each has a different 15 minute pickings. And the worst case is that worst 15 minutes happening at the same time. We probably want to deal with it instead of average conditions all the time. So that's looking at sort of conditions for this peak hour factor we kind of mentioned. And then this should be a ref turn on red, I guess. So cars go away even though they don't get the green. They can just make left turns. And also defining lane groups is another concept, which is fairly straightforward. And then supply side is that what the HCM is doing is, let's assume it's ideal condition and all 100% green and infinite number of queued vehicles. How many cars can get through this approach, this lane? And then they apply conditions. Let's say this is a lot of heavy vehicles. There's a lot of bus bays. There's parking maneuvers. They try to reduce the saturation flow rate. So this is one way to calculate saturation flow rate as a theoretical way. Or you could go outside and then collect number of cars passing at the stop bar, how many cars are passing through, and you can probably look at the headway and then what is the saturation headway. Under saturation, how many cars can get through. So once you know saturation headway, flow rate or saturation flow rate is 3600 over saturation headway, so you can actually calculate them. So that's something you can actually calculate for supply side. And supply side is not 100% given green to each approach. So they share the green time based on cycle length. So the you have cycle length and you can actually calculate so-called capacity. If you have saturation flow rate times, maybe you have duration of green time over cycle length, it'll giving you what's your capacity to provide. So that's the so-called V over C ratio. In the HCM, V over C ratio is a key variable to determine delay, control delay. And based on this, you can get all different performance measures. So this is how you understand performance of your synchronized intersections. And obviously, you can improve this operation by changing cycle length. And you look at the delay, changing duration of green times, you look at the delay. So you can actually sort of optimize your signal settings as well. So the HCM gives how to evaluate performance of the intersection with the different geometry, different volume, and then change of the signal settings. Obviously, capacity analysis is the key. We change number of phases. You could have two throughs only, or you could have eight phases and so forth, and cycle length and duration of green times are design elements. I'm not going to read all these lines, but the key is input of the HCM is the geometry conditions, the number of lanes. And we also consider the area type because the CBD area, Central Business District, has more activities and they have a less throughput because of a lot of parking maneuvers and even the delivery vehicles and so forth. Lane width, grades, turning movements, exclusive turning movement lanes is important. Parking is another factor. And traffic conditions, number of cars are important. So-called the base saturation flow is ideal situations, so S naught, and you multiply all those adjustment factors to make a realistic saturation flow rate, and then we decide the cycle length. There's some concerns about minimum green time. Again, this is driver's expectancy. You don't want to have a green time showing only 2 seconds or 3 seconds. Once you start the green, usually minimum green is 5 seconds for turning movement, and throughs are usually given as at least 7 to 9 or 10 seconds. And also you have a sensors, then you can actually decide the green time as well. So you have a sensor somewhere upstream, and then beginning of red, you can count how many cars are coming in, and that should decide the initial green time. At least you want to clear up those vehicle queued during red time. And also minimum pedestrian green time based on the pedestrian speed, walking speed, and also number of pedestrians. So they even consider there's a X number of 10 or 100 pedestrians, and they assume this is a sidewalk and this is a two ways, and they're going to be align each other to go one way, and there's a 4 people per row, and then this is a 6 rows are needed. So you can actually add that up to clear the pedestrian crossing. In real world, they are just mixed through, so it's not always work like that, but there's a way of considering those initial conditions. We talked about this concept of peak hour factors. The idea is that when we decide the peak hour, it's not like 7 to 8, 8 to 9, we are looking at a rolling 1 hour window. So this is one example. Let me go back. This is one example of showing that. So you have a 7 to 8:15 or longer, and we are not simply looking at the 7 to 8 and then 8 to 9. We are doing rolling of these And in this case, 7:15 to 8:15 has a higher volume. So that's our peak hour. So the peak hour doesn't have to be whole hour durations. And this is a peak hour factor equation. So basically, what we are doing is total hourly volume during the peak hour divided by maximum 15 minutes existing for entire hour. So 4 times peak of 15 minutes. So this is assuming 2400, and the maximum vehicle volume is 650. So, okay. So this is my peak hour, and out of these 4, this is the highest peak hour volume. So your peak hour factor is basically 2400 divided by 650 times 4. I have that actually equation next page. So this is how you calculate them. So 0.923 is a peak hour factor. What it means is that once we know the area of peak hour factor, and I just need to have a peak hour volume, and I inflate the volume to be, instead of 2400, here I'm going to inflate that volume to be 2600. So this is assuming that worst of 15 minutes is happening for the entire hour. That's how the HCM is doing it. Flow rate is also a similar way. You can do a 15-minute, 60-minute as a single period or multiple period. But if you consider peak hour factor, you're basically considering worst of 15 minutes happening for the entire hour. Saturation flow rate I mentioned about. You can use field observation or estimating using the HCM equation. Again, by definition, it's assuming 100% green for entire duration, passenger car unit, only passenger cars. They just keep moving, and how many cars are getting through. So typically in the US, it could be 1800, sometimes 1750 or 1850, depends on the situations. So these are the adjustment factors. So I mentioned about S naught as ideal saturation, base saturation flow. So I could assume this is 1800. And in reality, you may not be able to see 1800 because of lane width is narrow. Maybe there's heavy vehicles, there's grades on the slope side and bus bays and an area which is not CBDs, and lane utilization is poor. This could happen, as I mentioned. There's a bus syndrome, there's a bus, nobody will try to follow. Not many people follow that bus. So you have unbalanced lane utilization that will affect on your saturation flow rate. All these are the factors, and it's available in the HCM. I'm sure it's the same thing as in your Indo HCM as well. Sometimes the people use a 1900 as well. Adjustment for these and others are commonly done. Parkings are affecting as well. Bus blockage is another challenging issue. Bus often blocks vehicles. So that's why, I mean, the professor Goswami actually mentioned about a near side bus or a far side bus stop. So people favor to have a far side bus stop because of that issue. If you have a near side bus, and then even though you see the green and the bus is stopping and you cannot actually move, the simple calculation of doing how you actually estimate saturation flow rate. Again, this is probably fairly straightforward. So we assume 1900 as a saturation flow rate per lane. So you have to multiply number of lanes as n, and then lane width is not 12 foot, then you modify based on this. So this is a baseline saturation flow rate. Sometimes the people forget to multiply by number of lanes. That's important. And lane width adjustment, 12 foot. 12 feet is the ideal case. It's less than that, and you use this equation to adjust. So narrower the lane, your saturation flow rate is lower, obviously. And then heavy vehicle percentage is also adjusted. And then in your case, you have a CBD. Again, CBD has a lot of activities, and they may not be able to utilize the entire base saturation flow rate. Uh, some of the terminologies, startup loss time is probably you know this, saturation fluctuation you know. Effective green time, I'm going to explain that. And VOC ratio is another terminology. So this is in a way to look at how signal can be operated. So this is a time domain here, as a time domain here, and this is a saturation flow rate. So during red, no one utilizes time, no one, except for maybe emergency vehicles. So typical cars are not using it. And at the beginning of green, it's impossible to start at the same time as green starts. There's a countdown signals in the China. I don't know, Indo has it or not. You have, okay, so it might help a little bit reducing start of loss time. So they actually lose a certain seconds and then they pick up and then they operate as a saturation flow rate. And then once you actually clear up the queue, then you don't have a saturation flow out, right? So this is actually arrival patterns. And then at the beginning of yellow, no one, most people do not stop. Yellow means you have a chance to get through, right? So they utilize a portion of yellow as if it's a green. So if you are talking about effective green time, so the big green bar is display the green time. And in reality, people are using effective green time. So lose something at the beginning, and then they gain some at the end of green, so utilizing some of the yellow time. So this is what's happening in signal control. So how do we estimate startup loss time? Maybe this is not ideal for India case. This is a time between the vehicles, those are queued. So the key is that when you calculate this saturation flow rate from the field, you actually have a queued vehicles. You don't consider vehicles joining at the end of a queue. It has to be queued vehicle at the beginning of green. You could add one or two more if they're not moving, but to be safe, you want to consider queued vehicles at the stop bar. And then maybe this is the time taken from the first vehicle at the beginning of the green, and this might take 2 point something, maybe 2.4 seconds. And second vehicle maybe slightly less, third might be less. And if you go fourth or fifth vehicles, they might be stabilizing. This could be 2 seconds or 1.9 seconds, depending on how fast you are moving. So this is the headway that we are looking for as saturation headway. And before that time, these bars are sort of startup loss time. It's not just the first vehicle, it's happening at least a few vehicles at the beginning. And this is a loss time when we actually saw here the first, this time, portion of this is a loss time, right? So that's a loss time that we are calculating, that we can estimate from the field. And you want to do this for a few trials, not just single time. And then that way you can actually get the start of loss time from the field and also calculate, this is weird position, but if you want to know the H as 1.9 or 2 seconds, you can actually calculate saturation flow rate from the field. So this is how you estimate saturation flow rate from field conditions. This is an example. If you want to try it, that's fairly straightforward. So if you found that average headway after start of loss time is 2.2, and you get about 1636 as a saturation flow rate per lane. Per lane is important. This is another example that you can try out. So this is the queue positions. This is the trial number one. So I have a cycle number 1 to 10. So I'm doing this 10 times, 10 different cycles. And then first cycle has 7 vehicles queued. Oops. And second cycle is 10 vehicle queued, and a slightly different number of vehicles queued, obviously. And if you look at these, maybe 1.9 might be the saturation headway, but this is not the case here. This is not the case here. So there's some unbalanced, not always true, right? then how do you deal with it? One suggestion is that you can probably take an average. So here you can take average by 10, here average take by 4. So you can actually see this. Oh, okay, looks like a 2.0 might be the one. So it happens that 1.9 once in a while, more than 2 something, 2.1s are happening as well. So we want to try maybe this range of the value as a saturation headway. Again, this is not rocket science. This is commonly used. So that's how you calculate saturation flow rate for the HCCM method. Effective green time is the same thing we mentioned. So in transportation, we use lower character, upper character differently. Big G is phase time or displayed green time. And then small g with the E is effective green time. So we sum them up from the this displayed green time and yellow and red clearance time. And then we subtract lost times. Then that's going to be effective green time. This is similar to what we saw on that big chart, looking at the relationship between start of lost time, and then we lose something at the beginning of green, and then we gain something during the yellow. That's what this is. That's exactly what I was talking about. Same idea of, again, this is obvious. Interesting. And then we don't use the entire yellow because the people are beginning to worry there's a yellow been on some seconds and I don't want to make, I don't want to put myself into danger. Maybe that's my philosophy and some people may have a different philosophy of I don't want to get a fine or something. Next the concept is a capacity. So supply side of a signal is not 100% given to one approach. It has to be shared by different approach or phases. So whatever the capacity, capacity that we want to get is based on saturation flow rate. That's if we have 100% green, this is what we can process. And this is shared by portion of a green by the cycle length. So you have a cycle length of 100 seconds, I can utilize my approach, my effective green time duration. So that's why we get this equation. It's fairly straightforward as well. And this kind of shows that, so I know the V and I know the small c capacity. So again, lower and upper characters are different. The small c is a capacity, big C is a cycle length. So the reason I'm showing this is, so if you actually capacity as saturation times G over C, and then if you rearrange this, this is what you get. Here, V over S is something that is a fixed. So once you have a signal, like the intersection as a geometry and then volume, and V over S is a fixed, right? C of G is something we can control. We can have a longer or smaller cycles. That's creating different V over C ratios, right? Right, this is a fixed. So the key, and then also V is also fixed, right? So the capacity is a function of different cycles and different green times, so obvious. And how do we play with this to control V over C ratio? If you think about economics 101, you don't want to have conditions for every time you have a situation that's a one-to-one match, you want to have some rooms available to consider emergency case. So you want to have some redundancies. So your V, we don't want to have a V is equal to C all the time. If that's the case, it works for average conditions. It's not going to work whatever the over-fluctuating condition. It's okay for under-fluctuating conditions. So typically we decide what V over C ratio we want to design for. And again, this is depends on the volumes. If it's a low volume, you don't want to have a very big V over C ratio. But if you have a fairly big V volume, you don't want to have a very small V over C ratios. So typically people use 0.85 as if it's a reasonable volume, and try to do 0.9 or sometimes 0.95. If it's a very oversaturated, you cannot add more capacity, then maybe you go up to 0.95. So determining what X sub C is what we call VOC ratio, but VOC ratio we want to use, and that will determine cycle length. And once you determine cycle length, the question is how do we divide the green times to the each approach? And we use Webster's method, so-called equal degree of saturation, which I'm going to explain later, but that way we have a so-called critical movements, we get the same VOC ratio. So whether you are in the major road or minor road, most critical movements will get the same performance or services as a VOC ratio. Maybe it may not make sense, but we'll probably talk about it a little bit more. So typically, VOC ratio concept is we provide a big sort of a greenish box, and then actual flows are happening in the shaded hatched area. So that's the VOC ratio volume. And ideally, if you can reduce capacity, then this is going to be longer onto the saturation side, and then you might have a better utilization. Or if you have a bigger capacity, then you can have slightly shorter saturated conditions. Maybe you are often wasting your green time as well, if that makes sense. So the VOC ratio is the key, just fundamental economics theory. And highway capacity is solely based on the VOC ratios. I kind of mentioned this earlier. So X sub C is something we design. This is our sort of usual defined performance of the intersection. I want to define X sub C as something. Or in this case, we call it critical value of this is a summation of the critical movements. Maybe I can just give a quick idea of considering these. So you have two phases of these. And then what we want to do is, assuming the same number of lanes and saturation flows, one could be higher volume than the other. So this is a critical, right? And then among these, one is higher. So what we are treating on this VOS ratio is that we don't consider lower volume of V, we only consider higher volume of V over S. So using that, and then using another phase, V over S, some of those are key to calculating X sub C. The reason we are doing that is the same as we only control G and C, green time and then cycle length. So when we actually use a critical approach volume and saturation flow rate ratio, and then we have a way to dividing G over C ratio between those two critical ones. Maybe it does not make much sense. Let's go back to that one. So the idea I'm talking about is that, interesting. So the V over S ratio is for the critical movements only. Then if they are a different value, so one's a VOC ratio is 0.9, the other 0.6, and you can actually give the same VOC ratio by changing C and G ratios, if that makes sense. That way we are creating X sub C to be identical. So we are treating critical movements in the same level of VOC, if that makes sense. If not, probably, you can probably exercise this later on and then you'll see the exact same value as given. So that's how we decided this X sub C. The HCM equation, you probably have seen it, but I'm gonna go over fairly quickly on this one. So this one has three components. Maybe this is a queuing system, right? I mean, you know about queuing system. You go to Starbucks or toll booth, and the service depends on the how many operators and how long they take to serve, and also how many customers and cars are coming in. In theory behind this one is that they are sort of separating uniform arrivers and then random arrivers. So when you want to calculate delay, if everything is coming in as a uniform, it's a very easy to calculate, right? You can simply draw the line and so-called triangular polygons, and you can see the, how many cars are stacking up during the red and how fast they can get discharged during the green, and then you can actually track how many, the delay times, and you can estimate average delay per vehicle. That's a fairly easy. To calculate for random arrivers, we know it's going to be random arrivers. And in the signal systems, when you have multiple signals and nearby, they don't come at a random, right? So they have some platooning effect, and then they could have a arrival type. They could have everyone departed from upstream during saturation flow, arriving green time. That's probably a perfect case. And it depends on those situations. So they want to calculate the arrival patterns of those into a calculation of delay. That's a PF, shown as a progression factor. And also D2 is a term for random and then oversaturation delays. It's all based on queuing theory. The challenge of the queuing theory is that when you have a service rate, it's smaller than arrival rate, you cannot solve. It has to be a steady state or equilibrium. But in reality, in transportation, your volume to capacity ratio could be bigger than one for whatever reasons, especially when you design the signal in an improper way. So if you have a major street needing longer green and you put the smaller green time, your V over C ratio will be bigger than one. We have to deal with that situation. So they had to some transpose and then some treatment to consider D2 terms. And then D3 is initial queue. So when you analyze something, there's a queuing vehicles there, then you'll have to, they are adding up to the entire calculations. So that's basically described here. So uniform delays are fairly straightforward. X is a V over C ratio. You can actually derive this equation by doing quick polygon analysis. So this is a very straightforward of calculation. Again, I mentioned the progression of vehicle to the intersection. It could be upstream, red, actually hold the number of vehicles, and they depart as a sort of platooning, grouping, and then coming into the intersection during green. That's a good thing. This is how to measure quality of progression. And this is sort of approximation. So when you have random arrivers, we put the one. If you have a really poor progression, this is the one. Exceptionally good progression, this is what you use. Try to adjust sort of a delay at the intersection level. Even with the uniform arrivers, it's not always uniform. This is a so-called random and then oversaturation or incremental delay. This is a sort of derived and then modified based on queuing theory. So this calculates random arrival delay, and K's and I's are for actuated signals and different controller settings and metering conditions. I have some described descriptions here, but it's not that important. You can adjust these for actuated signal, and actuated signal should work better than pre-timed signals, so that's how they adjusted it. Again, as I said, this is an initial Q value. When you have a Q existing at the beginning of analysis, that's just accrue and then add up to the delays, and that's how they considered it. As I said, less than 10 seconds per vehicle is level of service A, and used to be this 80 was 60. Now they are changing it to 80 seconds per vehicle. That's how you define the level of service. So one example, if you want to calculate, you have a cycle length of 80 seconds and effective green time of 30 seconds, actual flow rate of 400, and then saturation of 1750. You probably want to calculate this as a G over C ratio as 0.375, and then capacity as 656, because G over C ratio is 0.375, and then volume to capacity ratio is 0.609. So in this case, we did not consider peak hour factor. So if you know the peak hour factor, you could have applied it to make it more proper. This is, you are calculating D1 equation. So D1 is assuming uniform arrivals, and if you put this X value and G over C and everything, here one thing I can mention here, this is a minimum of 1 over X. So if X could be bigger than 1, X is a V over C ratio, you just use a 1, because we cannot deal with oversaturated situations, at least for D1 equation. That's how you do it. And then if you have a D2 equations, this is a fairly small. So here, when you have a V over C ratio is a small, D1 is a major. If you have a bigger V over C ratio, getting close to 0.95 or something, then you have a fairly large D2 term because of fluctuations. And we ignore the D3 term here. So this is the last slide. I kind of mentioned a few times. The impact of a downstream congestion is not considered, at least for the HCCM equation. And there's no way to consider turn bay overflows because this is analytical equations, and they usually don't work very well. I know I went through very quickly, but I know you actually learned about basics of signals. This is a US version of it. And I wanted to explain some theory behind and also some personal experience and tips for using this technology. So any questions you have or comments?
The turn pocket, can you explain how does it
work? How does it work or what do you mean?
How does it happen?
When that happens.
Yeah.
So HCCM ignores when they calculate the performance. That's why people use at least the turn pocket. You have to use a simulation model to consider that kind of effect. At least for the link speed over, nowadays the tools are considering those. So when you have a spillback happening at the intersection of the link and they actually stop the simulation, then this is a bad situation. They try to avoid it. For the turn bay overflow, it's not trivial because this is really happening and that's affecting a little bit. It's not, so they don't consider that yet. So only way you can do that is a microscopic simulation to deal with it, if that makes sense. So the challenge of a turn pocket is that if you have overflow, and giving longer green is not right answer, because the longer green is always one point is a longer red for waiting. So that's challenge. One solution is creating the phase to be left and through together. So this is a road. So you are making right turn pocket and then throughs and this, right? So you could actually have a phase sequence going this and this going together. That way, this is not creating overflow. They can actually, they might be have something called demand starvation. There's a lot of throughs and this is not utilized. But still, it's better than not having overflows. So if you could not expand your turn bay, then one solution is using this simultaneous through and right turn that will solve that problem some level. So phase sequence is a very important parameter as well. Any other questions?